Well, we're here again to give thanks to the God of heaven who rules over all the world, who's given to his people a saviour for men and women to know life forever. And today we have a visit. Mervyn Neal from Come Dare Mission is here to share God's word with us. I'm going to introduce it and pray, and you'll see a recording of Merv preaching. So we're going to hear God's word. It's from the book of Luke, Luke chapter 5, and we're going to read from verse 29. Here's God's word. And Levi made him, that's Jesus, a great feast in his house. And there was a large company of tax collectors and others reclining at table with them. And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And they said to him, "The disciples of John fast often and offer prayers, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink." And Jesus said to them, "Can you make wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and they will fast in those days." He also told a parable. "No one tears a piece from a new garment and puts it on an old garment. If he does, he will tear the new, and the piece from the new will not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins, and it will be spilled, and the skins will be destroyed. But new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. And no one, after drinking old wine, desires new, for he says, the old is good." Well, we come, don't we? And again, thank God for his goodness, and we're going to pray. We're going to ask God to draw near to us, and then we're going to sing, and then we're going to hear God's word open to us. Let's pray. Father, as we come in these moments, we are a people who want to know the life of the living God. We want to know that new life, the new garment, that new wine that brings refreshing, that shows us all that we're meant to be in this world, a broken world, a world where men and women are taken up with themselves, turning their back on the living God. We want a life where we see Christ as our treasure, Father, pleasing you, a world where the pouring out of the heart of the God of heaven to a world that's lost eternal love, even to rebels, that we would demonstrate such love. And that's the working of the cross. It's the wonderful power of the Spirit working in us to show us it's only in that gospel, only in Christ, that men and women can be made new and live the life you've called us to live. And so we just pray in these moments that we would see what it is to be yours. We'd see what it is to be forgiven. We'd see what it is to have such a saviour. We'd see what it is to have a future that's eternal and true, a new home, new mind, new body forever. And Lord, in all of our troubles and frustrations, we pray even in these moments we'd see what it is to be yours, and that we want our neighbours and friends to hear of, you know, that Christ who keeps us, whether it's in our marriages, in our singleness, whether it's as parents, whether it's, Lord, with just dealing with hardships in life, that we know that this Christ, he wants all of us. He wants our heart and our mind, and he promises to give us a new future, a future where, just like him, we display that obedience to the Father and find the joy in serving him. And so we just pray, come near to us, give us what we need, set us free from selfishness, from sin, from seeking to serve our own needs, that we might display in this world the heart of our Father, who's good forever. For your glory we pray. Amen.
Yeah. Well, we're continuing to look at the Lord. Whoops, a bit loud. Jesus meeting with people through Luke's gospel. And we're in Luke chapter 5. Last time we finished with Levi throwing a huge party. Levi, who Jesus changed his name to Matthew because he saved him and called him to be one of his disciples. And he throws a huge party. But the religious teachers and authorities, they're already starting to question Jesus. But it's like when you try and witness to someone in the family who's not a believer, or witness to a work colleague, you know their questions are not honest. Their questions are always dishonest, because they're not questioning you because they want to find out. They're questioning to make a point, to get one over on you, to show you that you're wrong and they're right. And we see that happening here. There's actually three questions through the passage. Matthew throws this great big party. All the other tax collectors and sinners are there. And they say in verse 30, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? No, it's not an honest question. It's a question with a sting in the tail. If you were holy, if you were really God, you wouldn't eat with unholy, godless sinners. So that's what they're really saying. It's not why, it's we already know the answer why. We've already made up our minds about Jesus. But Jesus told them, and here's the wonder, here's the grace of Jesus. He uses people's dishonest, antagonistic questions to give them his gracious gospel answers. And that's a good way that we need to learn, that when people are antagonistic, even in their questioning, we should answer them with gracious gospel truths. And here's the first gracious gospel truth. Verse 31, it isn't the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I haven't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Church is not a hotel. Church is a hospital where people who are spiritually sick come to find Christ as their spiritual healer. And very often we all have different self-righteousnesses. And, you know, they should be better by now. They should be a nicer person by now. They should be a more godly Christian by now. We can all do it. We can all fall into that trap. But here's Jesus' words. Well, it's not the healthy who need a doctor. It's those who are sick. Well, it's those who know that they are spiritually sick. He says, I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. Oh, what a wonderful thing that is, isn't it? Christ has come. So he didn't stay in heaven saying, come to me. Christ left heaven to come to this sin-sick world to then call us to him. So he always makes the first move. Christ has come to then call sinners, mess ups, people who've blown it not just once, but a million and one times. I've come to call sinners to repentance, to a complete change of life, a complete U-turn, a complete transformation. And that's what the next passage is all about, this complete U-turn and transformation. Well, what does repentance look like? What causes repentance? So here's their second question, verse 33. They said to him, John's disciples, John the Baptist who'd just been beheaded, John's disciples often fast and pray, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours go on eating and drinking. Do you get the sting in the tail there? Well, we know John the Baptist was a godly man because he deprived himself. He lived in the wilderness. He ate locusts and honey, and you know that. And the Pharisees, well, they're godly. They deprive themselves. They fast and they spend prayer. We all know they fast and pray because we see them doing it. But your disciples, notice the emphasis on your disciples, go on eating and drinking. You see, the disciples reflect their master. The disciples reflect their teacher. So, well, they can't be godly. So, Jesus, you can't be godly. Because they're all enjoying themselves. And God's not about in people enjoying themselves. Listen to Jesus' answer. Again, wonderful words of grace. Jesus answered, "Can you make the guests of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them?" Imagine, so you're invited to a wedding. We got a family wedding in August. So you're invited to a wedding. You go, "Oh, invited to a wedding. I need to find my funeral dress. And I need to make sure that I am somber and tearful and sad." Be a bit out of place, wouldn't it? No? Wedding? It's a time of great rejoicing. You put on your best wedding frock. Or if you're a bloke, the wedding suit that you always get out for weddings. Always the same suit 20 years later. But you know it's going to be enjoyable. I mean, there might be a side of the family that will drink a little bit too much. And but by and large, people behave themselves. It's friendly. It's happy. It's a time of rejoicing. And Jesus says, you've got it all wrong. Got it all wrong. The time of mourning over your sin and over your failures has gone. Yes, there's lots of fastings in the Old Testament. It's interesting, in the Old Testament, fasting is always in connection with repenting of your sins, of showing your sorrow before God. And it's the idea of, you put on sackcloth and ashes, which is what you would put on to mourn a death. But you're mourning that you deserve death because you're a sinner. And you fast, seeking God and seeking his forgiveness. But he's come. The bridegroom has come. And this is the picture of God saying that I will come one day as a glorious bridegroom. And I will come and I will link myself to my church. And it will bring in the glorious messianic age of God's forgiveness, of being right with God. And Jesus says, no. The old age is finished. I'm the bridegroom and I've come. And these are the friends of the bridegroom. These are the ones invited to the party. So of course they're going to be eating and drinking and celebrating and full of joy. And then he mixes it with a dose of reality, verse 35. But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. In those days, they will fast. What were the disciples doing in between Jesus' crucifixion and the resurrection? Well, yes, they were trembling behind locked doors. But they were fasting and they were praying and they were seeking God's wisdom and God's help. Now, Jesus had already prepared them for it. You've got John 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 before he's arrested. He's been teaching them and preparing them and getting them ready. It's only after his resurrection that they get it. But there can be many times in the Christian life where you're a born-again believer, you know Jesus, you know you're forgiven, you know you're in his family, and yet he seems far away. Now, sometimes it can be because of your sin. Sometimes it can be that. And so you need to fast, and you need to seek God, and you need to seek his forgiveness once again and show that his forgiveness is even more important than food, that his presence is even more important than food. Do you know, sometimes he withdraws his presence, not because you've done anything particularly, no one big serious sin, but it's just like you've grown a little bit too complacent. And you've lost that sense of wonder and amazement at who he is and that he should want to be with you. And so he's there because he said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. But he takes away that sense of his presence. So you'll stop taking him for granted and seek him in a fresh, living way. And that's what he's saying here. You can't make the guests of the bridegroom fast. You can't make them behave like they're at a funeral. They're at a wedding. But there are times when in a believer's life that you do have to mourn. You've got to mourn the loss of his felt presence and seek him afresh. And then he tells this parable. No one tears a patch from a new garment and sews it on an old one. Well, ladies, you'll know that, won't you? You know, why? Why don't you put new material on old material as a patch? Well, the new material has still got life in it. It can shrink. The old material is dead. It's got no life in it. It can't shrink. So if you put a new patch that's got life in it and can shrink, and you sew it to a piece of dead old material that's got no life in it and can't shrink, as soon as you wash it and it dries, the living tears away from the old and it's worse than it was before. And just in case we don't get it, he gives us another picture. He says, no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Now, some of the old translations say old wine bottles, and that doesn't work because a bottle is glass and it can't stretch. Okay, but this is the idea of, in Jesus' day, you put wine in newly cured animal skins. Why? Because they were supple. And as the wine fermented and as the gas increased, well, because the wineskin was supple and could expand, that was great. But Jesus says you don't put new wine that's fermenting and full of life in a dead, brittle, old wineskin. Because if you put what is new and alive in what is brittle and old, well, as soon as that wine ferments, the wineskin, it cracks and you've lost what is valuable. He says, no, new wine must be poured into new wineskins. Now, why is Jesus doing this? Well, because of the questions of these religious people. They were serious about the law. God said, no, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and you must love your neighbor as yourself. That's how the whole of the Ten Commandments, all of the moral law of the Old Testament is summed up. You must, you must, you must, you must. And they thought that by keeping the law, God would start to love them and he would save them. But they had totally misunderstood the meaning of the law. And in fact, just to make things worse, they had added hundreds and hundreds of other man-made laws on top of what was in the Bible. Lots of little extra rungs to be working your way up to God. And the people who felt that they'd got to the top could feel really good at themselves because they were looking down on all the other people that they thought that were on the lower rungs and not become as good and as holy as them. But what is Jesus saying to them? You are dead and lifeless. Someone who thinks that they can earn their way into God's good books is dead and lifeless. And Jesus says, but I've come to bring what is new and living. That the new wine of God's grace, the new wine of the gospel, the new cloth. But it's not new. It's old. He says, and no one after drinking old wine wants the new, for he says the old is better. Now, it seems to be a contradiction, doesn't it? You know, you put new wine into new wineskins. You don't put a new patch on old material. You only put new material on new material. But after you've drunk the old, you don't want the new because the old is so much tastier. What does he mean? But he's saying, what came before the law? Think of Abraham. Was Abraham saved by keeping the law, or was Abraham saved by knowing and trusting Jesus coming before he was ever born in Bethlehem? Well, the law wasn't given until 400 years after Abraham. The law wasn't given until Mount Sinai and Moses and Israel being rescued out of Egypt. So what came first? Being saved by God's just gracious meeting and calling you. I mean, Abraham, God's word says, was a worshipper of all the pagan gods of Ur of the Chaldees, a sun worshipper. And yet Jesus met with him and said, come and follow me, and I will bring you into the promised land, and I will make of you a great nation. And even I'm going to be born into your family, which was a miracle because he was too old to have children, and so was Sarah. So that's what he's saying here. He's saying, this isn't something historically new. This is what has been promised even before the law. This was always God's intention, to send his son into the world with God's glorious, new, frothy, living, fermenting life into dead, hard souls, to make us new. He's not about patching people up. He's not going to put a gospel patch on an old, religious, self-righteous person. He's not come to patch us up. He's not saying, well, most of you's right, there's only a little bit of you wrong, and I'm going to put a patch on that wrong bit. No. He needs to make us completely new people. But it's nothing new. It's what God had promised right to Adam and Eve. When he put a curse on Satan, when he put a curse on the land, but he didn't curse Adam and Eve. Instead, he gave them a promise. From you will come a male child, and he will crush the serpent's head. But in the process, he will be bitten. He will die. And he gave them the picture of those animal skins with his bloody hands to cover their nakedness and guilt and shame. Third question. And this is all linked. This is sometimes where our chapter headings are. We've got to realize they're not originally in the Bible. They've been added later on. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the cornfields, and his disciples began to pick some ears of corn, rub them in their hands, and eat the grain. Perfectly natural. It's hot. The video there, we'd have seen it. It's hot. They're hungry. They're walking long distances. And, there's a snack at hand height. You just pick the ears of corn, you rub them together, get the chaff off, and munch them. A bit of high-energy protein bar. And they're doing that as they walk on. But the Pharisees are walking alongside with them, and they're like, that's work. That's harvesting. It's forbidden according to the law. See, you can't be holy, Jesus. You're a lawbreaker because you allow your disciples to be lawbreakers. Some of the Pharisees asked, why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? Notice the sting in the tail. It's not the why is not really what they're asking, is it? Why are you doing what's unlawful? They don't really want to know. They've made up their minds. Don't confuse me with the truth and with the facts. But it's that snidey, sneaky way of making a point by asking a question. You know, it's passive-aggressive. Some people are very good at it. They ask you a question, but you know it wasn't a question. You know it was a statement. Here's Jesus' third gracious answer. Jesus answered them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry?" So here's David having to flee for his life. King Saul has tried to pin him to the wall with his spear. David is running for his life, and some of his mighty men have gone with him. And they've got no weapons, they've got no food. They go to the tabernacle, and David says to the priest, "Is there any food here?" And he says, "Well, there's the bread of the presence of God." Or sometimes it's translated the showbread that was there in the holy place where only the priests were allowed to go. So that who is the bread of God's presence? Jesus. "I am the bread of life who has come down from heaven." So here was a picture of who Jesus is and what he was coming to do. And then there was the lampstand, which is a picture of the Holy Spirit. Then there was the curtain. Then the other side, there was the what? The Holy of Holies, where there was the ark, the mercy seat, God's throne. So there's a picture of the Father's presence. This side of heaven, you have Jesus and you have the Holy Spirit. When Jesus takes us through the curtain into heaven, there we will have the Father as well. But here there is Jesus, the bread of life. Give us life. And then there's the Holy Spirit. You can almost imagine a big smile on Jesus's face when he's not just giving a historical example of when what wasn't allowed by the law was allowed. The law said only the priests were to eat this bread, but the priest gives David the bread. But that bread is not just to sustain David physically, it's a picture of the presence of Jesus. And you can imagine a little smile on Jesus' face as he's giving this historical example to these self-righteous, arrogant, religious teachers. "He entered the house of God, and taking the consecrated bread, he ate what is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some of it to his companions." They probably choked at that point, and they weren't even eating the corn. But then he makes this huge claim. "Then Jesus said to them, 'The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath.'" What does that mean? Jesus is making a massive claim. It sort of comes out in a funny way on that video. "Who do you think you are, God?" Interesting question. He's much more direct than that. He says, "I am the Lord of the Sabbath." What does that mean? Well, he takes them right back to Genesis and he says, Father, Son, and Spirit were working on those 6 days of creation. In the beginning, God the Father, created the heavens and the earth. The Holy Spirit was hovering over the face of the deep. And Jesus, the Word of God, spoke. And everything was created on those first 6 days. And what did God do on the seventh day? He Sabbathed. That's the Hebrew word for rest. He Sabbathed. Shabbat. Who inaugurated the Sabbath? Jesus. He stopped creating. Didn't mean he stopped working, because he, from that day on, he's been sustaining all of his creation. He gives you the air to breathe. He sends the sun to make the plants grow. He sends the rain and the wind and the seasons, and so we will eat. He's even speaking now from heaven to make your heart beat. He's the one who inaugurated that first Sabbath. So, not because he got tired, but for two reasons. So he could sit back and he could enjoy his creation. And so his creation, especially man, could enjoy their creator. But it also shows that there's another day's work still to do. That God has got something new still to do. His new creation. And here Jesus is joining these two things together. New wine, new patch. I'm Lord of the Sabbath. I'm the one who knows what the Sabbath is all for. Because I created the Sabbath. But I don't need to stop working because I'm God. I've still got something new to do, the new creation, which is why Paul says in Corinthians, if anyone is in Christ, new creation, the old has gone, everything has become new. But he's also claiming that he's the one who gave the whole law at Mount Sinai. Because where's the teaching on the Sabbath found? You shall keep the Sabbath day holy unto the Lord. Where was that given? That was given at Mount Sinai when Moses went up the mountain and the Lord met him in the cloud and the thunder and the earthquake and every single Israelite, over a million of them around the mountain, heard Jesus speak audibly. And Jesus says, I'm the one who created those first 6 days and gave the Sabbath. I'm the one who met the whole of Israel and gave them the Ten Commandments, even the commandment on the Sabbath. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. So I know what it's all about. You guys, you haven't got a clue. Then on another Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and was teaching, and a man was there whose right hand was shriveled. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. Now, some commentators think they actually planted the man with the withered hand in the synagogue because they knew what Jesus would do. So he's a plant. Now, that might be true. It might not be true because actually we're not told. But we know there was a man with a shriveled hand there. And by now, these religious people would have had a pretty good idea what Jesus is like. He's gracious, he's merciful, and he helps the helpless and the mess ups and the sinners. And he cares much more about people than he seems to care about the law. Although that's not true, because he came to fulfill the law. But that's what it looked like to them. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. Well, he's already let the disciples break the law by harvesting grain to feed themselves, so we know what he's going to do here. Oh, yeah, we're right. He's going to be a lawbreaker again. Jesus knew what they were thinking. Here's another of his claims to deity. Because the Bible says, only the spirit of man knows what a man is thinking. Now I can look at you, and I can have a guess at what you're thinking, but only you know what you're really thinking. And the Bible acknowledges that. Of course, the only other person who knows what a man is thinking is God. And so here's Jesus again showing his deity. He knew exactly what these religious people were thinking. And he said to the man with the shriveled hand, get up and stand in front of everyone. So he got up and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, I ask you, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy it? See, he's being so gracious with these horrible religious, nitpicking, don't confuse us with the truth people. He's been so gracious to them. He looked around at them all and said to the man, stretch out your hand. Now, the video actually captured this really well. Can a person with a shriveled hand stretch out their hand? No, they can't, because their hand's shriveled. It's like when Jesus said to the paralyzed man, so that you know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive people their sins, I say to you, stand up and walk and carry your mat. Now, can a man who's paralyzed and who had to be carried by his mat and his four friends, can he stand up? No. So here's the wonder of the new wine, the new life of God's kingdom. He speaks and he enables people to do what is absolutely physically impossible under the old creation. And it is through Jesus's speaking, his words of grace, that old creations become new creations. When they listen, and because Jesus is saying it, they do it, even though it seems utterly impossible. Stretch out your hand. And whether it was the way Jesus said it, the way he looked as he said it, or a combination of both, or God's Spirit applying it to that man's heart, probably all three, the man does what is impossible. He stretches out his hand, and his hand is new. He did so, and his hand was completely restored. And they were so grateful, and they marveled at what they had seen today. No, that's not what it says. Here's the awfulness of hard, cold, religious hearts that belong to the old creation. They were furious and began to discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus, how they could get rid of him. That's one of those really sad verses in the Bible. Here is Jesus, the bridegroom, come for his bride. Here is the one who is the Lord, not just of the Sabbath, but of all things. Here is the one who can make people new creations. Here is the one who can forgive sinners. Here is the one who can pour in his new life. And they want to kill him. They want to get rid of him. That's why it's so hard to be a Christian. Because if that's what it was like for Jesus, and Jesus is perfect, and you're not, and I'm not, is it any wonder that when you try and witness to someone, they come with those sneaky, snidey, don't confuse me with the truth questions that end up making you feel bad? You're the one with all the problems. Yeah, you're a religious zealot and so narrow-minded, and you're the one with the problems, not them. Of course, I was always told by my dad, be careful when you point your finger, because there's at least three pointing back at you. I came across this. It's an old Indian proverb. Read it. So this is from the Dakota tribe in North America. When you discover that you are riding a dead horse, the best strategy is to get off. Okay. When you discover that you're riding a dead horse, the best strategy is to get off. However, modern teaching, even religious teaching, tells us you need to buy a stronger whip. You need to find lighter riders. You need to harness several more dead horses to the first dead horse, because if you put lots of dead horses together, that will pull you along. That's called the Church's Together movement. Put the dead churches all together, bound to be life. What you need to do is arrange an overseas field trip to study other dead horses, and that will help you to ride yours. No, it's not dead, it's just impaired. Give it a new label. What we need to do is rewrite, downsize the performance criteria for dead horses. No. We need to find additional funding for dead horses. That will cure the problem. What we need to do, promote the dead horse to the position of a supervisor. That will cure it. I thought that would make Stephen laugh. That's the sad thing, isn't it? That's how people think. The old creation. There's nothing wrong with the dead horse. We need to change its name. We need more money. We need to educate it better. Everything else. No. Find a living horse. That's what you need to do. Well, Jesus is offering way more than a living horse. He's offering new life. He's offering eternal life. He's offering himself. I read this testimony. Ben was a very successful businessman. His professional life was flourishing. His family life was challenging because he was the parent of several teenagers. For him, Christianity was a distant, disconnected reality. But his wife was a believer. And he started to talk to his wife about Jesus. One Sunday, I was surprised but pleased to see Ben in our Sunday morning service. At the end of the service, he approached me at the door and his eyes were filled with tears. He explained that while he'd been visiting Washington for a conference, he decided to go to visit the National Cathedral. He slipped into an empty side chapel and just sat down for a quiet time of reflection and to ask God if he was really there. There, unexpected and half-heartedly sought, God's Spirit simply came upon him, and Ben became a new person. The awe and wonder of the grace and truth of the Lord Jesus Christ blew his mind, answered his questions, met his needs. Jesus just met him and changed him. In an instant, his life was utterly redefined and has been ever since. We're in Barrie. We sent out Christmas tracts every year. And then normally January, I'd go off to India for a few weeks. And I came back and I started to preach on the book of Jonah. And this guy was there. Never seen him before. And he came up to me afterwards. His name's Colin. And he said, I had one of your Christmas tracts, but I heard that churches hate Christmas tourists. So I decided, well, I'm not going to be a Christmas tourist. I'll come after Christmas to church. So he said, this is my first Sunday. I said, oh, that's interesting. And he said, yeah. He said, can I come and meet with you? So I said, yeah, yeah. So he came and met with me. And he said, you're probably going to think this is a bit strange, he said, but I've been an atheist all my life and I decided to write a book on why Jesus is a myth. And he said, as I started to do all the research, I thought, well, you know, the Bible is the biggest fairy tale book of all. I'll start to read what the Bible says about Jesus. He said, and then I got your tract and I've been thinking and pray about it. He said, I think I've met Jesus. He's not a myth. He's real. And he'd been gloriously born again. He'd become a new creation. And at the time he was working in the big AA offices in the centre of Cardiff, which is now a block of flats. And his mate, best friend, sat on the desk opposite him, is Andrew. And Andrew was going through an awful time. His His wife had just left him after taking out loads of loans in his name, maxing all the credit cards in his name, and then just did a runner, leaving him with all the debt and their teenage daughter, Rachel. Hannah. And so Colin started to talk to Andrew, and he says, I've met Jesus.
He's... Didn't he have a pencil or something?
No, that's someone else. He said, I've met Jesus. I've become a new person. And Andrew went, yeah, I've noticed you changing. So Andrew started coming along to church, did Christianity Explained. Andrew is now a deacon in the church in Barry. Utterly transformed. See, Jesus is not about putting a patch on me and you. Jesus is about coming and making us new people, a whole new way of thinking, a whole new way of looking at this world and eternity, a whole new way of looking at Jesus and God, a whole way of looking at other people. You see, you can't love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, but Jesus has done it for you. And you cannot love your neighbor like you love yourself. You can try, but you can't. Jesus is the one who's loved his neighbor more than himself. And who's your neighbor? Your worst enemy. The parable of the Good Samaritan tells you that. Who has loved his enemies more than his own life? Jesus. And he died on the cross for our sins, and he's risen again. And he says, come to me. I'll make you a whole new person. That's when we got saved. But I don't know about you. I know there's still an awful lot of brittle old wineskin in my life. But where's the areas in your life where you find it so hard to change? Well, you can't change yourself. You've got to ask Jesus to take those brittle areas that are still there. You've got to ask Jesus, though, those bits of old wineskin that are still in your life. You've got to say, Jesus, William, those that you know, the areas that are brittle better than I do, where I can't stretch, I can't move, I can't change. Jesus, you've come not to make part of me new. You've come to make all of me new. You know those parts of you that are old cloth with all the rips and tears. And Jesus hasn't come to patch you up. Jesus has come to make all of you new. Every area of your life. And it's not something he does once. It's a continual process. Jesus, here I am. Change me. Be renewing me. It says in Romans, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Jesus is about changing you. He's about changing your thinking. He's about making you a complete new creation. And that's only going to be completed on the day when you see him face to face. And then the Bible says, then you will be like him, for you will see him as he is. At the moment, we're in that really confusing middle bit. If you think of old creation is like a circle, and his new creation like a circle, and the two overlap. And we're in that really confusing bit of the two circles and that bit in the middle where it's overlapping. There's still the bit of the old creation. There's the new creation, but there's still an awful lot of the new creation to come. And that middle bit where they overlap is between Jesus' first coming and between Jesus' second coming. But at Jesus' second coming, old creation is all gone. And there will only be the new creation. As Jesus puts it to John in Revelation. Then there will be no more crying, no more pain, no more tears, no more sickness, no more death. For the old will have passed away and everything will be made new. Hallelujah, we're still living in that confusing middle bit where there's still opportunity for people to come to Jesus and say, make me a new creation. I don't like the old me. It's ugly and it's selfish and it's dirty and it's self-centered and nitpicking and condemns other people. Jesus, I don't like it. Take it away. Make me new. Make me right with you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for that day when you broke into our lives and you made us new creatures. You gave us that faith to trust in you and to repent of our old way of life. Thank you. You didn't just come to patch us up, but you came and have poured the new wine of the gospel, the new wine of your presence into our lives. You've made us new creatures. But Lord, there is still so much of the old us that is ugly and dirty and horrible. Lord, that can't change, sometimes doesn't want to change. Please would you forgive us, and please would you renew those stiff, brittle areas that are still in our lives for your glory, honor, and praise. Amen.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. His mercy.